Welcome back to the Extra Point. Welcome back to Extra Point. This past weekend, we had the game of all games that decided who lifted the Lombardi Trophy this season. And we saw it was the Kansas City Chiefs. I'm joined by Adam and Benicio. Guys, what do we think of the game?
Well, it's kind of went how I expected it to go score-wise. I thought you were going to have a healthy balance of offense and defense. But once again, you saw Mahomes play terrible in the first half, and then he just had a dominant second half, was unstoppable with his back against the wall, and showed why he is one of the greatest quarterbacks ever to play the game of football, and also why Andy Reid is one of the greatest coaches ever to coach the game of football.
Yeah, I want to say Reid was phenomenal as well. And we got to think that game started just kind of slow in a way. It's just there was no real tempo to it. The turnovers were costly early. The McCaffrey fumble was big early, and then the McCole Hardman catch, and then boom, Isaiah Pacheco fumble as the Chiefs are getting right into the end zone. Fortunately, though, we got the offense going in the second half, and Patrick Mahomes showed us why he's Patrick Mahomes. I mean, we got to the end of that game. I don't want to say it was inevitable, but you knew you had one of the clutchest quarterbacks of all time on possibly the biggest drive of his career. You knew he was just going to do something, and it was fitting that it ended that way. I think if you wanted it to end any other way, you couldn't have had it end any better.
Yeah, I think watching the game beginning, I kind of disagree with you, Benicio. I thought it was going to be a high-scoring game. I thought it was going to be a lot of offense. Both teams, as of late, have been awesome offense, a lot of yards. But it was, like, very slow, and I'm like, is this going to be, like, the big game a couple years ago between the Rams and Patriots where it was just an absolute, like, defense
I was thinking
fence.
The same
Julian
thing.
Julian Edelman, MVP.
Yeah, he had awesome game. But I was like, oh, no, is this happening again? Like, shout-out to the defense, but, like, I was like, I want to see some scoring. And if you were to tell me before the game that Juwan Jennings would be the only person with a passing touchdown after the first half, I'd think you're crazy.
If the Niners win the game, do you think he wins? Because he had a touchdown in the fourth quarter as well. You think he wins Super Bowl MVP?
I think he does. So I'm going to be honest.
Maybe McCaffrey, though, too, with all those yards he picked up.
But yeah. I'm thinking the play from Juwan Jennings would have had their two touchdown scores.
Yeah, that's true.
And I feel like when you think about that, if somebody accounts for all the scoring, you should win MVP.
Because I'm happy you brought that up, Adam, because when I was watching the game, I turned to my dad, and I'm like, who's going to win?
Here we go!
Oh, the big game MVP. Like, who thought
Luca.
Who thought that was going to happen? And it was just like, I don't know. But then, obviously, Mahomes worked his magic, and it was a no-brainer that, you know, he would win the game, and he would win that award. But let's transition. We saw the end of that game, went overtime, second big game to ever go into OT, right? What were you guys' thoughts on it? It was.
You got to know the overtime rules. There's no excuse not to know them. I heard that Chris Jones gave his teammates a long speech prior to the game about what they would do if it went into overtime. He was very specific as to what the rules were. It seems like the Niners didn't have that conversation, and it cost them.
It's the first time that you can't really be upset with them because it's the first time we've gone into those overtime rules. I mean, we look. Nance and Romo were also, I think, a little bit confused. Everybody, there was no real certainty on exactly what was going to happen. I think at the end of the game, you're all kind of sitting there like, oh, the Chiefs were running down the clock at the end of overtime. And then you're thinking, all right, they're just going to kick a field goal. But then you realize that it's no one knew the rules. Like, it keeps going. It says, it's basically like you're starting an entire new football game, which is something we had never seen before ever in football in a way that, or at least now in the playoffs, where if we go back to a couple years ago when the Chiefs played the Bills, Mahomes goes down, they have that 13-second drive, and then score a touchdown, the Bills never see the ball. That's just now the way you've been used to it, just getting a stop in the defensive end and then trying to get it on offense. But now that's just completely not the case anymore. So I could see kind of where people were confused with that.
Yeah, and I agree. I think I really don't understand it where, like, the clock was going down. If the Chiefs didn't score a touchdown on that drive and they didn't kick the field goal and time expired, it goes into that second overtime. Why is there time then in the overtime? Why isn't it like college where there's just no time limit? That is something that I think the NFL might have to work on a little bit because there's no purpose for the time.
Well, they said there's four new quarters. So
yeah, it's
a whole new
quarters.
Game.
So that's the plan there, what they're trying to do by it.
Let's talk about overtime in general, too. So I know, obviously, it was that Josh Allen game, the Chiefs and Bills in the playoffs, where the Bills never got the ball. Chiefs scored a touchdown one, and a lot of the Bills Mafia were salty that they didn't get a chance to the ball. They switched the rules where both teams get possession. How do you guys feel about that? I think that's fair? Or do
it
you
is.
Think,
you yeah? have to do that, especially after that game. You can't just snub one team of making it to the championship game or the big game because they lost the coin toss. The coin toss should not decide the winner.
I think in the regular season, the way they do it, it's fine. But I think in just such a high-stakes situation, I think giving both teams guaranteed possession is something that we know after, obviously, the Mahomes 13-second drive. It's something that got pushed for, and it works. But I think again, there's still some flaws in it and things that need to be improved upon it.
I'm going to be honest. I'm not a fan of it at all. I feel like the way the rules are made now, it doesn't incentivize a team to have a good defense. As long as you invest in offense, the offense scores, that's all that matters. And I think there's three phases of the game, offense, defense, special teams. You got to rely on all teams. And you have the opportunity. It's not like the offense automatically scores when they get the ball.
Your defense
has an opportunity to stop them.
Gassed
you
by
know?
Them.
But with offense could be gassed too.
Yeah, could depending be, on how long you're on the field. If you're on the field for 37 minutes in a game, that's a completely different story.
That is true, but generally they say you want to control time of possession. You want your offense out there more than your defense because it's more grueling to play on defense.
For sure. But love it or hate it, that's going to do it for this segment of Extra Point. Stay tuned for more.
Welcome back to Extra Point. NHL just had their All-Star game. We're coming up on the trade deadline. We're at the midseason mark, and I'm here with Chloe and Ava, and we're going to discuss what we think the rest of the season outlook, what we think about some of the teams, and yeah. So we'll start with the Atlantic Division. We have Boston Bruins on top of it right now. You'd think they'd fall off a little bit after Bergeron's retirement, but they seem to be doing just fine.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, Bergeron retiring, that's pretty huge. He's been in the league for a long time. And a lot of these guys that are on the Bruins are kind of old, like, you know, Pasternak, Charlie McAvoy. They've got their all-star goaltenders, Ullmark and Swayman. And they're coming off their record-breaking season last year. But like I said, they're still cooking, and they're President's Trophy contender right now. Mm-hmm. Not top of the league, but they are top of the Atlantic Division. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, yeah, I could see them making a cup run if they hold where they are now.
Yeah, honestly, I mean, after last season, that was crazy. First round exit, like that whole thing.
Yeah.
But I mean, I don't like Boston's team personally, but it's kind of interesting to see how they're still doing so well,
yeah. You
know, given everything and just, yeah, I mean, it's kind of, I'm not that surprised though, that they're still like contenders, that they're still in the run and President's Cup, like.
Yeah, Boston definitely still has a lot of talent there, and you got teams like Florida, Tampa Bay, Toronto, teams you would expect to do well, mm-hmm. all of them in playoff position right now.
Right.
You got the Red Wings at 60 points. They're currently in the second wild card spot. A little bit of a surprise, you know. They haven't made the playoffs in about 6-7 years now, and this year they seem to be in the race. So,
yeah, it's looking really crazy in the wild card race right now. I mean, I know we haven't moved on to the Metro yet, but the Devils are in a kind of tough situation, and they're kind of fighting with these Atlantic Division teams, like you said, Toronto and Detroit, who have not been projected to play very well. I mean, Toronto has, but Toronto's always projected to play well.
Yes.
And they always just come up on the short end of the stick. Like, all of us in the NHL know that Leafs first round exit day is the best day of the year. Like, it's always bound
to happen. Didn't happen last year. Finally got over the hump last year.
But they still haven't had
early rounds.
Yes.
Early exits. Yeah.
But they still haven't had a cup, you know, win in who knows how long.
Yeah, since the 50s, I think. It's been forever.
It's been a very long time.
Yeah. So moving on to speaking of the Metro, we got the Rangers and Carolina, two teams you would expect to be up there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunately for us Devils fans. Yeah.
Everyone always wants Rangers on top because, you know, huge market, you know, New York City, the big bad Rangers. No one ever wants to see them win, but also everyone wants to see them win because there's so many Rangers fans, speaking as a Devils fan. But, I mean, they started off the season, you know, cooking. They're still on top of the Metro right now. But, I mean, the gap is closing. Like you said, Carolina and the Flyers are creeping up behind them. And they've fallen down in the rankings of the league. They used to be on top, but now I think they're sitting, you know, maybe like 8. They're, you know, again, still top 10, but it's kind of low. But it's crazy because Igor Shesterkin, after like his injury, has not been playing good.
Yeah, Jonathan Quick's
at all.
Been better.
Jonathan Quick is doing better than Shesterkin.
Yeah.
Like, what world are we living in? Like, that's crazy.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah, and you got, speaking of the Flyers, like, how out of nowhere. They were supposed to be last
so
in the match.
So bad. Like, it was they so were, bad, like, in recent years, and just such a turnaround. Like,
yeah. And the Flyers, they're playing great. And then you got this whole swath of teams here, the Devils, Islanders, Capitals, and Penguins, all still solid playoff mm-hmm. contenders. There's seven teams in this Metro Division that could be in playoff
cups.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. I'll say for my Islanders, very, very much in like a weird position right now with the coaching switch. I mean, the overtime is so bad. They're on track for the most amount of overtime games in NHL history. So it's just really interesting because they also aren't winning those games. They keep losing them. Like last night, they lost in shootouts. Shootouts so bad. Overtime. They have a few good wins, but like they just can't. Like the only reason they have so many points is because they keep pushing overtime.
Yeah,
it's insane.
Four of these Metro teams will be playing the Stadium Series this weekend. Devils, Flyers. Me and Chloe will be at that game.
Look for us. And then in the stadium.
Rangers and the Islanders on Saturday. So that'll be or Sunday. Mm-hmm. That'll be fun to watch. So moving on to the West now, we got the Central Division: Dallas, Colorado, Winnipeg. Three teams that seem to separate themselves from the rest of the division.
Yeah, I think. Honestly, looking at the Central Division, it's kind of what you can expect every year. Like, Winnipeg's been playing pretty well recently. They've kind of gone on a little bit of a hot streak. They sat at first in the league for a little bit, but they've kind of fallen off again. But, I mean, we always see these teams like Dallas, Colorado. They won the Cup a couple years ago. They've always seemed to be playing well. So, I mean, I'm not surprised to see them up top, but it's what you get.
Yeah, I mean, Winnipeg, they did. I honestly expected Winnipeg to have a bit of a fall off this year, but they seem to be doing just fine. These three teams, Dallas and Colorado, you expect them to be up top.
Yeah.
And then Winnipeg, yeah, I think that these three are going to be the top three teams in the Central in the playoffs.
Hellebuck's insane.
Yeah. Vezina, definitely the Vezina front runner.
Oh, absolutely.
For sure. And then you got St. Louis and Nashville battling for playoff spots. And then you got Chicago, the worst team in the league.
Poor Chicago.
Yeah. Bedard. Supposedly Joel. Getting back to hockey activities this week, but that loss has been crucial. They have 31 points, last in the league.
Yeah.
That's rough.
They're worse than San Jose.
Yeah.
I mean, they're kind of doing that dance with them for bottom. But, I mean, Bedard being injured, even with him being out, like, and having him on, like, and off the team, Chicago's just bad.
Yeah.
Like, I don't
one
know.
Player is not going to fix the whole
no.
thing. It's a big like, issue.
Free Bedard from Chicago because he did not need to be sentenced to his first year on this poor team and with a broken jaw. That's just added insult to injury.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
no, they're not doing so well. And you mentioned Minnesota. I don't know if you mentioned them, but
Wild.
They're so mid.
Yeah, they had the coaching change. I had high expectations in the preseason. They are not living up to it.
They are doing so bad.
Yeah.
They replaced their head coach with John Hines, who used to be a Devils head coach. He just doesn't really have a good reputation in the league for bringing
teams.
He's
not that guy.
He's really not the guy, especially after losing the first, like, 14 of their 19 games and going on a 7-game losing streak to the beginning of the year. John Hines isn't the guy you want to bring onto your team to get you out of that slump. And, I mean, you've got, like, Marc-Andre Fleury on that team, who's now, like, the second most winningest goaltender. Like, he's old. Like, he's been in the league forever. So, you know, but they've got some talent on that team. So, I don't know. They just, I guess, need a complete overhaul or new head coach again, because clearly it's not working for them.
Right.
Yeah, so obviously the Central, pretty jam-packed. Moving on to the Pacific now. I think we had the most surprising team in the league in this division.
Oh, my God.
Vancouver.
Vancouver.
Like, are you kidding me? Like, this team, they made the playoffs during that weird COVID year where, like, everybody was let in.
Yeah.
And then
like, the Flyers made the playoffs that year. Come on. Like, that, it doesn't count.
Yeah. But now they're currently first in the league, 78 points. Elias Pettersson, Brock Besser, JT Miller, Quinn Hughes, Thatcher Demko, all these guys stepping up. They had like 5-6 all-stars. It was absolutely insane. What do you guys think about them?
I honestly, like, it's kind of shocking to me personally. I feel like I didn't really follow, I'm not really following the West as much in like the Pacific Division, so it kind of just like came out of nowhere for me, I feel like, seeing that. But I don't know. I mean, their defense is just rock solid. Like, absolutely like a brick wall. Like, once you enter their zone, it's like, it's
yeah,
impossible.
That combo of Quinn Hughes and Phil Peronik have been absolutely dominant.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, Vancouver, just President's Trophy frontrunners, I would say. It's crazy.
And I think it's really good to see kind of Quinn Hughes kind of have his, you know, breakout and his little, like, solo run over in Vancouver, because all last year with Luke making his NHL debut with his brother Jack on the Devils, it's been all those two Hughes brothers, and then Quinn's just kind of, you know, right. been over in the, like, slump that's
yeah.
Vancouver.
Yeah.
But
in
now,
the corner.
You know, yeah. the tables have kind of turned, and now Quinn Hughes is the star, and of course Jack and Luke are still doing great, but it's like all eyes are on Vancouver now, so mm-hmm. he's kind of having his revenge run over there.
Yeah, and then another team in this division that I think is definitely worth discussion is the Edmonton Oilers. Coming off that, what, 17-game win streak, was
16.
It? 16
it
games.
Got snapped
yeah.
earlier this week
yes.
by
so
Vegas.
Edmonton, everyone was calling for their heads at the beginning of the year. Oh, my God, they're below 500. They were Stanley Cup favorites. Make the coaching change, 16 straight wins, and they're solidly in a playoff spot
that
now.
It's insane. Like, I mean, there's been a lot of coaching changes, and some teams, like, haven't adapted well, like the Wild. I mean, not the guy for them, but yeah. Yeah. just Edmonton, like, that's insane. Like, that's kind of unheard of to click like that immediately and just yeah. be on that streak is just insane.
And I hate Edmonton. I was one of those people preying on their downfall, and seeing mm-hmm. them, you know, below 500, like, even doing worse than San Jose at one point, made my day.
Right.
But, you know, it is what you, like, when you have a team with Connor McDavid, like,
yeah.
of, like, something's got to happen.
Eventually, like, they're going to get that yes. breakthrough.
Yeah. McDavid had that slower start to the year. Like,
yeah.
like, this isn't the McDavid production. Like, he was still a point-per-game player, but not the McDavid production we expected. And now he's back in the heart race. He's
yeah.
doing McDavid things. And, yeah, it's crazy. And we got, I mean, Vegas, L.A. Vegas looking to defend their Stanley Cup championship. So we'll see if we can do that. But I think that's going to just about wrap it up for us here on this segment.
Don't forget, San Jose is still doing
yeah,
real bad.
Yeah, San Jose is... They're bad.
Bottom tier.
There's no saving. That's going to do it for the NHL segment. Stay tuned for more. We got MLB coming up.
Order in the court. Welcome to our final segment of Extra Point here today. I'm your host, Dean, joined, of course, with Mr. Bear, Nolan, Frank, and Gabby. Today, we're going to be recapping all of the MLB free agency that we have missed. A lot has been going on with the big game, of course. We have been doing a lot of coverage of that. But there's been so much happening with baseball that I cannot wait to dive into this. The last time we really talked about it was last year. I cannot believe it.
It is crazy what happens when baseball season isn't the prominent season.
It is, and it's very upsetting because I know here at Hawk TV, we all absolutely love baseball. So let's waste no time and get right into it. Starting off, of course, the biggest thing, without a doubt, this offseason, Shohei Ohtani and Yoshinobu Yamamoto signing with the Dodgers this offseason.
He should have been a Yankee, Yamamoto. It's very disappointing. They both should have been a Yankee, actually.
Go Yanks.
I agree. But Ohtani breaks the market. $700 million for 10 years.
Oh, my God. He broke the stock market, crashed again.
Unfortunately, I think he did. But most of that money is actually being deferred to later on in his career, which has opened up a lot of controversy. And I want to open up the floor to you guys. I mean, what do you think of this contract? This is definitely two of the biggest players to sign. I mean, I know Frank and I are very upset that Yamamoto is not a Yankee, but what do you guys think?
My thing with Ohtani is I think he's worth, like, a lot of money. I don't know if 700, because you're combining hitter and pitcher. He just got Tommy John. He's not going to be pitching for the next 2 years. When he comes back to pitch, he's probably going to be pitching for another 3 more years, and then he's going to go back to hitting. Mm. Right there, I don't think that's worth like an extra like 300 mil. But the defer money, I just can't wait till they're a poverty franchise.
I mean, it's definitely a smart maneuver because you think about it, they're really only paying him, I believe it was what, like $2 million a year.
I agree with defers, just not like they should be like a limit on the
defers.
Yeah, I agree.
It's a little crazy.
Yeah. I think paying him $680 million at the end of his career, pretty much, when he's like, what is he, like 27 right now? He's going to be, what, 37 when that deal is over? Who even knows
that's
if he's pitching anymore?
Good job.
Yeah, thanks. See that? Quick math. Mr. Bear, what do you think about this?
I think he should have been a Met.
I've expected better from you, Mr. Bear. I'm sorry.
I agree with you, Mr. Bear.
That's great. Frank, your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, $700 million is a big gamble. Like, we've never seen a contract more than $500 million before, and then we get $700 million.
Crazy.
You're gambling on him being healthy, which Tommy John just coming off of it.
Mm-hmm.
And you're gambling, I mean, he's a great player, don't get me wrong, but it's a DH at the
yeah.
end of the day. He's a DH. He doesn't field. $700 million. I think it's a little.
I wouldn't be surprised if he goes back to fielding when his pitching days are over.
My question is, where would he play?
Outfield, probably.
Outfield. He used a playoff field, yeah. and then once his arm started aggravating, right. then they just went strictly pitcher, and then Tommy John first time.
Could throw him at first base too. You could put anybody at first base these days.
That's true. I mean, Harper just made the switch, and he was actually quite good at first. Gabby, your thoughts?
Well, I've been to Yankee Stadium.
Did you like Yankee Stadium?
Yeah, the hot dogs are really good.
They are pretty good. Did you ever have the Aaron Judge burger? It's very good.
I didn't, but I played softball in third grade.
Okay, so moving on to our next free agents. Younghoe Lee signing with the Giants. A solid move right there. They had Correa for a week. They had Aaron Judge.
I forgot there was a baseball team called the Giants, too. I was really confused for a second.
I completely forgot he went to the Giants.
Yeah, he signed.
Yeah, I kind of got thrown under the radar.
It was very under the radar signing. It kind of happened in like a lot of like the middle of other free agents signing.
Yeah.
But to quickly glance over some of these other guys, Sonny Gray signing with the Cardinals. He said in the beginning of the offseason he wanted to. Yes, question.
Going back to the Giants.
Yes.
I just learned that the lead singer of the band Journey was a huge San Francisco Giants fan.
Is that true?
Really?
My father just told me that actually over the weekend. So
that's awesome.
I was prepping for this.
Sweet. That's great. Mitch Garver is a Mariner now, so that's
nobody
cool.
Cares about that one.
Nice depth for them. They also made a pretty big trade over there for Jorge Polanco, which I really like, solidifying that outfield with J-Rod. Marcus Stroman's a Yankee. Frank, I got to talk with you on this one.
Came out of left field. I mean,
it did.
Like,
so?
Yes.
Hey, I've been to Yankee Stadium. Why won't you talk to me about this one?
What's funny is that I have a feeling that Stroman, we know this, Stroman's been wanting to be a Yankee for like
basically
his entire
career. He's wanted to be a Yankee for so long.
Exactly.
Like his whole career has been based on that.
Ever since 2019, that deadline when the Mets eventually traded for him, he expressed interest in the Yankees.
He said, always wanted to be a Yankee.
I know. So badly. And
it's like his whole career was like based off of that.
I know.
Just so you guys know.
And he mentioned previously, he was like, oh, the Yankees don't really have like that dog ace pitcher aside from Cole. You know, it's just a bunch of question marks after him, pretty much.
CeCe Sabathia was good.
CeCe Sabathia was good, like, 5 years ago.
He
was good.
You remember that game when he fell off the pitcher's mound?
I do.
I was at that game.
Really?
Yeah, the stadium, like...
Yankee Stadium? Like I've been to Yankee Stadium.
I actually also saw him at Diamond Nation. I had a game.
Really? That's awesome. I love CeCe.
I saw his son. His son was a stud.
Great guy.
I have a question.
Yes.
Who's that guy at the bottom?
Oh, we're going to get to him. We're going to get to him. Don't
you
worry.
I love him in Star Wars.
Josh Hader going to the Astros, 5-year deal, broke the market for relief pitchers.
Han Solo.
I didn't see this. I didn't see this signing really come. I'm surprised the Astros really made a big move in ace.
Yeah.
Especially because they have guys like Presley.
It's another reason to hate the Astros.
Yeah, and they have guys like Presley, so it was really shocking.
Yeah, very, 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 very shocking. Mets, Nolan, the Mets got Sevy.
Yay!
I mean, that's kind of all they did, but I know a lot of Mets fans are very upset about this offseason. I know they wanted Yamamoto.
Yeah, Uncle Stevie's not doing his job.
Yeah, he's really not living up.
Not to be confused with my Uncle Steve. Different guy.
He's really not living up to his expectations as the owner of the Mets. Everyone thought, you know, where's the big moves? Where's all the big money spending and stuff? And it just really hasn't come.
And we're not even going to do it on Pete.
Yeah, Uncle Stevie's kind of...
He's been very, very underwhelming. But, guys, let's move on to some of these trades. Actually, we're going to get to this right after, but some of these trades, real quick. Juan Soto, guys, I'm so happy Juan Soto's a Yankee.
No, he's great. Yeah. He flew the Millennium Falcon with Chewbacca, and it was really good.
He did that. He did that all right.
He did that. He definitely did. And he flew all the way over from San Diego to New York, and now he's playing
Taylor Swift
right
did that,
field.
Too.
That's great.
She flies from her bedroom to her bathroom.
That's what I'm saying.
Precisely.
She flew from the box to the field.
All right, guys, enough of the nonsense. I really need to talk about Juan Soto. You guys do not understand how excited I am for Juan Soto to be a Yankee. He is going to be so incredible alongside Aaron Judge. You have MVP
best
one
duo in the league.
And
it's also like great
best duo
like,
in the league.
It just like he was never a Jedi, so it's really good that he gets to be a Yankee.
That's great. That's really, really good. Let's move on to some of these other trades. Corbin Burnes is now an Oriole.
Gave up nothing for him, pretty much.
I'm very scared of it, too, because now they have an ace that could rival Cole.
Oh, yeah.
King Cole?
King Cole?
Yes, guys. Andy's pitching for the Yankees, in case
Yes! That's where he is. He's at training camp.
Yeah, he's at training camp right now. Pitchers and catchers did report today, by the way.
That Andy is there.
Wait, really?
Yes, as you can see in our quick facts right here. Pitchers and catchers
I'm late.
Today, actually. Andy's literally there.
They told me I had to be there next week.
You're pitching for the Yankees, too?
No,
well,
I'm
you're
catching.
Like, you're not king yet. You're not King Coles. You're like Duke Nolan.
He's not quite there yet. But in other quick news, the Phillies are discussing an extension for Wheeler. That's pretty cool because they just locked up Aaron Nola long term. So now they are looking for Wheeler to lock up their one and two for long term.
That's pretty good. That's pretty cool.
It is very, very cool. And of course, big quote from Aaron Boone today. The Yankees are talking about winning it all. They've been talking about that for so, so long now. Aaron Boone goes, listen, we are hell-bent on winning a championship this year. And I think they got it in them.
Yeah, they have a really nice stadium, too. I've been there.
It's a great stadium.
We should probably pick our biggest winners so far.
We should. Let's get over to that.
Han Solo, definitely.
Han Solo?
Yeah.
You think so? So, I mean, because, you know, Han Solo, considering he is practically a Jedi, and we mentioned Han Solo, I think it's fair to put the Yankees as, you know, the biggest
winners. Oh, we're talking about teams? I thought we were talking about individual people.
Yeah.
I mean, Dodgers are easy, number two.
Yeah, I'm definitely not biased putting the Yankees at one. Dodgers, number two.
I'd throw the Orioles in there.
Orioles, yeah. I was going to say.
I think the Orioles.
I know myself.
We just think alike.
I think the Braves.
Just telepathy. Just doing telepathy.
Biggest loser, Angels. Sorry. Easy.
Yeah. Biggest loser, I feel, has got to be.
You lose Ohtani, and did they even get anyone?
They did not. They lost Lucas Giolito, too. They lost a lot of people.
Yeah.
I'm going to throw the Angels in there. You lost your franchise guy. Who knows if Mike Trout will ever be the same again.
That's the craziest E I've seen in my entire life.
I'll fix it for the grammar.
Look at his R for Josh Hader. It's a straight line.
All right, you guys want to get up here and write this stuff?
Yeah!
Anyways, that's enough time for today's show. We have a lot more that we did not cover. Hopefully we can get to cover that on another show. But that concludes everything we have for today. We will see you guys next time.
Probably not me, though.